Hello, and today I'm going to be covering how to use the simulator in MPLAB X. The two projects I'm going to use is the capture project from my previous video and the ADC read project. Both of these projects are available on my Git. Now, the first thing you want to make sure of is the project that you're debugging is set as your active project. This is indicated by your project being highlighted in bold, or if you want to change your project, that is the active project, you set right-click and you say set as main project. And when you have the project set as your main that you want to debug, you go up to where it says default or the set project configurations. You go to customize, and then in your project properties, you say under conf default, you select the simulator. You click apply. And once you have applied, you can change the options of the simulator by clicking on the simulator drop-down. And the main thing here to pay attention to is instruction frequency. Since I prefer to use 8 MHz, I set my instruction frequency to 2 MHz. You can change this to anything you would like for your specific PIC. Also note, since it says instruction frequency, it means that how fast the instructions execute and not what your oscillator frequency is at. We just apply. Now, on the code aspect, this is the only line you need to remove from the project, as the simulator does get stuck because it has no oscillator to confirm if it's on the correct frequency. Now, the next thing is to set a breakpoint. You can just simply click on the line number and it will create this red block and a red line. Now, what the breakpoint does is it stops the code at that point in time or point in execution, so that you can see what has changed in your code and whatnot. I'm just going to add a quick few breakpoints here. Okay, now the few breakpoints I set is just simply halt at start of my code, just so I have a reference to know when it has started after compilation. Now what I want to track is the value in T3Con. So I add a breakpoint just after T3Con has been initialized to see the value inside it. And then I go to my high priority interrupt to check if I have entered my interrupt and what is happening inside of my interrupt. And then I add this final breakpoint just to tell me my main loop code has executed. Now, to monitor the values inside your code, you simply go to Window. This may differ on different platforms, but I'm not sure about that. Window, Debugging, and then we add Watches. Now in Watches, you can add almost any variable that you want to monitor. You have a similar situation with also with Window and Debugging variables, but I prefer to use Watches. Now first what I want to see is what the value of TCON is. So I simply just add to enter new watch. I simply double click that and then add TCON3 to it. Next what I want to monitor is what is the current state of capture and compare register low. Simply add that and then capture and compare register high as well. The other two variables I want to monitor is the value of register TMR3 low and the value of TMR3 high. Now note these are case sensitive. Then what I want to monitor is the value of capture value, which is going to be the combined value of capture and compare high and low, and the value of timer overflow 3. Now to add an external input into the code, like for say a button press, we go again to Windows, we go to Simulator, and we add Stimulus. Now here we can add a pin. Say for the capture module we want to use RC1, we can use the dropdown, or we can just type in RC1. And then we have the action, which is by default set high. And you have all your different types of actions like set high, set low, toggle, pulse high, pulse low, and set voltage. The set voltage is a recent feature I learned about. for this instance, since we're using the capture module, we just want to pulse the pin high. Then we can say we want to pulse the pin high for a value of 1, and then we can select what units we want to use. For instance, how it's set up by default is pulse it high for only one cycle, so 0.5 microseconds. But when we drop down, we can have nanoseconds, microseconds, and milliseconds, and seconds. For this instance, I'm going to pulse it high for 1 millisecond. Now to run the code, we simply click on Debug Main Project. As you can see, the code automatically stops at my first breakpoint. Then we go to the Stimulus tab. Okay, it automatically opened my Variables tab, which I'm going to close, just for neatness sake. Now as you can see, when the code's running, it says what type of variable it is. Oh, where's my timer 3? Okay, but you can anyways, you can add it live, TMR3L, okay, TMR3H, okay. So it shows if it's an internal register or if it's an external data variable. And then you have the value in hex as well. If you have a floating point number, it does display it as a single floating point number. Back to the debugging, after your project has run, you can use step into to step the code line by line. You can use run to cursor to go to wherever you have clicked on the code itself. Like say for instance, I am at TCON 2. We just say run to cursor, and I'm not sure what the difference is between step out and just continue. It looks like it does the same. The others I haven't found much use for. But since we are at TCP2Con, watch the value of T3Con. It's currently 0. Now it's going to stop at line 58. If I click continue, you see the value has changed to 18 hex. Now red indicates a change in value after the last run. We step, we can see the next line goes black again. Now we start the execution of the code. Now we go to the Stimulus tab, and if we pulse I, we will jump to the interrupt code. Now shown here, it shows the current value of timer 3 low and high as FA and 96. And then the value of the capture low and capture high. So this is the difference in time between when the capture event happened. Now if we run a continue again, as you can see, the cap overflow timer 3 has duplicated the time from overflow TMR3, this variable. Now if we expand capture value, we can see that the member CCP low and CCP high are duplicates of the capture value of capture and compare register low and capture and compare register high. Now what I can do is I can step the variable. Now I can see I'm going into my if loop since the boolean was set true. And then in real time, I can add another variable, cap value, as an unsigned int. It's currently set to 0. And then I can add also in real time a new breakpoint. Let me just click continue. And then we can see capture value has now the copied memory data from capture now, which was 93 hex in the high byte, and then E8 in the low byte. And then we can continue running the code in the background, and then we can stimulate again the RC1 pin, and then we can step the code again and see the variables change through the code. Then again, we stop at return. We see we have the two values into cap value. And then if we just want to add more pins, we can say A and 0, and then we can add the values again for it. And then if we want to stop debugging, we just click finish debugging session. And that's the basic of debugging code in real time. For code optimization, we have another useful tool, which is the stopwatch, which we go to window, debugging, and we click stopwatch. I'm just going to run the code again. We execute until we start running the main loop, and then we trigger RC1. Now this is why we set the instruction frequency earlier, so we can get timings on our code execution. Now we clear the history, and what we can do here is, say we execute the code, you can see it took 25 cycles to execute this interrupt. So approximately 12.5 microseconds. Clear history again. Click continue. And we go to stimulus and we stimulate RC1 again. And then on a stopwatch, you can see that took 2.11 seconds or X amount of cycles to execute. Stop. Next, what I'm going to do is debug a analog pin. So we go to the ADC read project, set that as the main project. We go to the project setup, go customize. We make sure it's on the simulator and not PIC3 or any other of the hardware tools. We check in simulator if the oscillator is set to the instruction frequency. And then we click apply, click OK, go to the main code. I remove this line. I add a breakpoint to the start of the code. And then I add a breakpoint to the ADC to LED value. Now you can save your watches as separate files with this icon. I'm not going to use that in this tutorial for now. Of course, unfortunately, the watches tab is global and not project specific. So I'm just going to remove this quickly. And the only thing I am interested in here is what is the value of that ADC result register high and the ADC result register low. Now we go to stimulus. In this project, we use analog zero to read the voltage of a pin. Then we go to set action. We say set voltage. And let's say we want 1 volt on the pin. Now I discovered that the value can't be used as decimal. We change the units to millivolts and then we just change the value to 1000 millivolts. Now, when I add a row, call it VDD, and add another row and call it VSS. We also say that to set voltage, and set voltage, change VDD to 5 and VSS to 0. Now, you can also, if you're using external references on your ADC, you can use VREF plus pin and the V negative pin. It depends on how your code is set up, but mine's set up to reference to VDD and VSS. Now we can start the debugging. We go to stimulus. We first set the voltage of VDD and VSS, and then we set the voltage on analog pin 0. Then we can execute the code, and we can see the voltage on ADC, the analog result register low is CC hex. Well, something interesting to note is if I set this voltage to 2500, so 2.5 volts, which is half the reference voltage, and execute the code again, after setting analog pin 0, I get a 2 in my high result register and 00 in the analog result register. Since this is a 10-bit ADC, we have a maximum value in our ADC of 1023, and then half of that is equals to 155.5. Now the PIC will round up instead of rounding down, because you would expect the value in ADC result high to be 0x1FF. But it is 0x200. So the PIC takes your value and rounds it up instead of down. It's just something I found interesting. And that's a basic introduction to using the simulator. Hopefully you found this useful, as I found this useful when I started coding on microcontrollers. Any code that I've displayed will be linked on my Git. A like, share, comment, and subscription would be greatly appreciated. Thank you. Have a nice day.